from the writers of MILF Manor. The new musical, Witchy. Look to the Rochester sky. Can this new witch, a fish out of water, tell her family's husband about her witch identity? Or will she suffer? But with hits known as Mitrabajo es Bruja, Literal Mente, and Yo Tango Internet.
Coming to the West Hare Auditorium in Rochester this fall.
Hello, this is Captain Poodle speaking. Are you ready to find love?
Yes, ahoy, matey.
Love.
Do-do-do-do.
Exciting and new. Go online. They're catfishing you.
Shocker.
Fiancé. Soon you'll be flying to parts unknown. 90-day Beyoncé. Marrying someone you've only met on your phone. Be they French or Chinese, a brand new K-1 visa's the key.
Ooh, the key to what, Poodle?
To love.
It's reality, yes. Let's love.
Oh.
Witched. That's wicked, Manuel.
They are meant to be on television, both of them.
I agree. I love him. I love his sense of humor.
I love him. I love her. They're together. Yeah.
Witched.
Witched.
As soon as that happened, I was like, yeah, here we go.
But why would he? He sees a picture of a witch. Why wouldn't he?
I just
say that.
Witched. It's just witched.
It's just witched.
Witched.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
It'll play really well in Rochester. Y'all, we're back for about 10 days of a tour back
Less
in L.A.
Than that. We are. This is your Happily Ever After, Season 8, Episode 7, Humpty Dumped Me.
Me.
Humpty Dumped Me.
That's one of my favorite title names we've had in a long time.
They've ever had. I 1,000,000%. 180% agree.
Yesterday, I was in Toronto. I was in the frozen north.
You were.
The Canada. Now, it was a lovely, lovely, lovely time in Canada, in Toronto.
And now you're back in your dungeon.
Now I'm back in the dungeon in the back where it's clouds. It's blue skies here, but it's 60s. And as you announced, it's cold today.
I am cold. I am cold.
It was a cold snap in Toronto. It was kind of cold up there.
Which everybody said it was prettier before. And then.
Nope. And now it's going to be in the 80s next week there.
Who knows what the fuck we're going to bring to Nashville and then Florida. Hopefully a hurricane just doesn't come up like last time we were there.
Locusts. That's what I'm going to.
And Peggy's ready. She's ready for them. The return is happening.
Y'all, we had a great, great time in Cleveland, Detroit, and Toronto. I think both Cleveland and Detroit, what I will take away from Detroit is feeling uncomfortable on stage with my body because I didn't realize my whole ass would be hanging out. I did not realize that. But they saw it all. Y'all saw it all and liked it.
Yeah, Gino and Jasmine were going to stay, and I saw you come out showing your ass. And
maybe that's why they left.
Jasmine started to vomit, and Gino started, he went blind, and they left.
I think, you know why they left? Actually, they told us later is that I think it made Jasmine a little uncomfortable because people were fanning them, and
they just weren't used to it.
They weren't ready for that.
Yeah.
And Jasmine's the introvert, y'all. If you didn't know, we did have Gino and Jasmine at our Detroit show. They were lovely.
Beyond lovely.
Could not be more kind of, I wouldn't say down to earth, because Gino and Jasmine are never down to earth.
I mean,
but
are
they're
we,
very normal.
Would you classify you or I as down to earth?
Maybe no. I would say down to earth, but keep going so you'd be in hell. No, I'm up in like the ether. You're trying to grab me. I'm not down to earth.
I don't think that's it's not who we are.
I'm not someone you want to introduce to your family because I'm going to say something offensive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's me. Yeah. And I'll say something inappropriate.
Yeah.
That's basic. Yeah. That's going to
someone, I was talking to Michelle from Blighted Day today, and she said, I may be able to get ChatGPT to write Southern stories and I could just play them so you don't have to talk about them.
Oh, well. It'll probably just remind me of other stories I don't know. That's probably what's going to happen.
And you'll talk on top of it. Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to get ChatGPT to do a Southern story. So maybe one day I can phase you out just to be a robot.
You know, I do have a little bit of that. Thank you for reminding me. I do have a story. I went with...
I didn't ask.
Well, you reminded me now. I went with my friend... my friend Don McCoy, who's an influencer, and I post her, my godson Waylon, and she works a lot with No Kid Hungry, which is a fantastic organization for childhood hunger in America. So we went to this thing. It was at this billionaire's house in Beverly Hills, and like wine. If it was great,
name dropper.
Lisa Loeb performed.
I love Lisa Loeb.
You forget that song
Stay.
It's such a fucking good song.
She had more songs.
I know, she played that.
No one really knows them.
And then she played another song that I really liked that was a newer song. And then she played a pancake song because she does children's music now.
Uh-huh, yeah.
She was great, ageless, looked fantastic.
Yeah, still rocking the glasses, glasses.
She has an eyewear line and she pimped it out.
You know what? That is synchronicity.
Yes.
So we should lean into the things that we're given.
We are. So So the event, you know, they were having people
was
speak.
Was Nine Stories there, her band?
No, just her and the guitar.
So there were no stories, not just, even one story?
No, just her and a six string. And so
they've been cut.
They've been, they're out. But she, so of course they did like an auction of some things, like a trip to Italy and stuff like that. So it was one of dinners. But one of the guys spoke and it was really interesting. And he was talking about like kids that are hungry. He said, you know, he said, we often tell our children to dream. He said, but you can't dream about being a doctor, a teacher, or an engineer when you're hungry.
Yep.
You can't. That's a privilege to dream. And he said it to me. And even though I knew this, it like all hit me that literally all of my father's trauma and issues came that he just was fucking hungry. All of it.
Way to start the show on an upbeat note.
Wow. So I was already feeling the presence of my dad. And then I was like, kind of felt like my dad was there. It was weird. And then they showed a clip of somebody talking who received services. And they showed several women and with children. And they showed this one woman talking in a minivan from Missouri. And she was talking, and they put up her name, and her name was Stacy Marr, M-A-R-R.
Maybe a distant relative, or someone your father's father fucked.
Possibly. Possibly.
Because your father had several families, or your father's father had several families, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah. It pulled me. I started crying. The next thing I know, I paid $2,000 to go to a dinner with that woman who runs matzah. She's cooking for people at her house. So I'm going to go.
Oh, Nancy Silverton?
Nancy Silverton. Yeah. She's doing a dinner. I was like, I'll just put it on the credit card.
Oh, I want to go.
My friend Dawn's coming.
Thanks.
Well, maybe if you wanted to hear the story. And we're excited to begin with.
That's fair. I did poo-poo your story.
Y'all, we've got other big news.
We do? I don't even know what the news is ever.
We're recording this on April 25th. The Mercury retrograde is over.
Yeah. Boy, she better be. She fucked me without lube. I'm so tired.
I know. I said that. And as I said that, I feel my floor vibrating in my apartment. And I'm like, was that an earthquake?
No!
It scared me. Oh, but so hopefully things are going better for y'all. Because this retrograde's taking no names.
Don't travel. Don't start a tour in Mercury.
Start a tour on Mercury.
This Mercury has been a bastard. Ooh, son of a bitch bastard.
Anyway, anything else we got going on?
We're on fucking tour still.
We are.
We have next four. leg three, the third leg of our tour, it will be Nashville coming up on the 7th, Tampa coming up on the 8th, this is all of May, and Orlando, the city where dreams are made of, on the 9th, and Fort Lauderdale on the 10th. God, there's a lot of Florida cities.
A lot of Florida. I'm looking forward to it. I love Tamps last time. We're not going to get to really hang out as much because it's wham, bam, bam. But I think we're going to have a little bit of time early in Nashville. I got to take you to Biscuit Love. It's trendy. Everybody goes there. But holy fuck. Because I consider you a biscuit savant.
I'm not a biscuit snob. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and for me, they're the best biscuits I've ever had. And so I want
we'll
to test
see
your,
about that.
Yes. I want to test your taste level against Mother Poodle's biscuits.
Those biscuits we had in Portland were really good.
Oh, they were good.
Those are really good biscuits.
Yeah.
Okay. I had some recently. No, the ones we had that place in DC. Those were good biscuits.
Not even comparable to Biscuit Love.
Wow. Okay.
Of course, there's a line to wait outside, and you don't like that. But it's in a real trendy area, so I could wait in line.
I don't give a fuck.
But I could wait in line for the biscuits, and if it takes like 30 minutes, you literally, there's so many gay guys there, you could go hook up with someone and then come back, and when we're timed, I can just like, hey, we're about to be set. And you'll say, hurry up and come, and then you can go meet.
Or maybe you can just throw a biscuit on me, and I can open my, while someone's banging me, and I can just open my mouth.
Out the window.
Exactly, and go, and I just catch it as they're railing me.
Like that bread man from Beauty and the Beast.
Marie, the baguettes. Poodle, the biscuit.
Poodle, the biscuits. But yes, we had a wonderful time. Thank you so much to Toronto and our friend and colleague and just social media extraordinaire, Caitlin, was a wonderful host.
We premiered our original song called To All Our Queens, a Songfinch original song by, I'm going to get his name wrong.
Simon Austin. It's Simon Austin or Austin Simon. Simon. Either one sounds like a porn name.
I think it's Austin Simon.
You know, oh my God, Simon Austin is a producer, mix and songwriter based in Toronto. He was in Toronto.
We should reach out.
He is credited as a song and it's produced over 3 million streams that have played across Canada.
It was a fun song. It was that style of singing, this very simple, planned, kind of like 2010. Is he hot? Oh no.
I don't want to show you a picture.
Oh, no. Then he's going to be gay, right? Oh, this was meant to be.
He's younger, it feels like.
You better watch what you say.
He looks like he's in maybe his mid to late 20s. He is very thin, with dark hair, dark kind of furry eyebrows and long brown eyelashes with, it looks like, light eyes. That's not your type at all, right?
Yikes.
But more importantly, I think he has a big dick.
I can't do this right now. I'm going to be all overstimulated.
I just sent it in the messages on Zencastr if you want to click on it and see.
In Zencastr, I don't know where those are.
There's a thing that says chat.
Oh. Oh. Oh, he's cute. Oh, no. Oh no.
We should have had him come and perform that live.
Oh my God, he probably would have asked us to pay him, wouldn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, he should be paid. I don't know.
We need to
next
move
time.
On.
Maybe he could perform it live on Instagram.
Again, he would need to be paid. He's not
Could he do it for a couple Tim Hortons cards?
Do for some smart a bag of Smarties.
Can I give you some Timbits if you'll sing our song on Instagram that you wrote?
Don't think that's gonna work.
How about a coffee crisp? Maple syrup. These are some of the gifts people were given.
I am not giving away my maple syrup.
That maple syrup made my bag quite heavy.
Oh, yeah.
I'm enjoying. I'm gonna make some pancakes later and eat some maple syrup on them.
Oh, that sounds delicious. I'm sure you will protein load before because you'll be terrified of your blood sugar dropping. After
I have to have a lot
bacon.
Of protein before because pancakes make my blood sugar drop. Yeah, it definitely does. Y'all, Love in Paradise is back. If you've been, I don't know if. TLC has uploaded it onto Max or Discovery Plus yet. The main problem, I don't know if you guys heard about this, they blurred the guy Luke's butt, but in the mirror with his dick, and they showed the man's full dong. You didn't know that? That's
no.
Why it hasn't been up. They showed his dong. It's not something to write home about.
I've got to tell my friend. She's going to be horrified for him.
His dong was out.
I did find out he's an actual mining engineer and has a degree in geology.
Wow. So it's not crypto.
No, which apparently, I said actually while I was explaining.
Yeah, people read you.
I was like,
read you
I don't know
said,
if this is right, but this is
what
I
read.
And
fuck
I was
you're talking about.
Completely wrong.
You don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
But I liked
my I didn't
my
know,
way.
So I let you kept going.
I said this could be wrong. I think that's how it should be, though, mining.
Just anyway, Love in Paradise, y'all. Ooh, it's definitely worth the watch.
It is.
I'm pretty sure one of our shows will probably be covering it on the tour. I'm going to be pointing to that one. Probably Orlando.
Do we want to tell people what shows are going to be there?
I can tell you right now because I've already done it.
Are you sure? I'm looking at it too. I mean, well, here, I'll just say. So Nashville, it's going to be Happily Ever After, episode 8, part 1.
Yep. You're right.
Oh, I thought you were going to do the next one.
Oh,
and then
I'm not looking at it.
Okay, then I'll tell you. Then Wednesday in Tampa, it's going to be Happily Ever After, episode 8, part 2.
Yeah.
And then on Thursday, the 9th, Orlando, the city where dreams are made of, it's going to be Love in Paradise, episode 3.
Yes. Because episode 2 will be this week. And then Fort Lauderdale, we're still on the fence of figuring it out.
Maybe
we're not
Love
sure
After Lockup, it may be Seeking Sister Wife.
So,
but it's going to be one of those.
Yes.
We'll see.
Maybe we'll have people vote.
But you could do a poll.
But the audience should really vote. Instead of the
should.
People.
Y'all, this Sunday, wait, never mind. The YouTube Live was great. Hope you were there.
It was a whole hour.
We do that every fucking time.
I showed my ass.
You did.
Someone in the Sissy Squad posted a picture of a poodle with a bare ass. You should see it. It's just sitting there. His ass is shaved. And Michelle had sent that to me a long time ago and said, I've never seen a more accurate representation of you.
That's you.
And I went, I know. Even
that
by the look
you.
In its eye. So that poodle with a bare ass was, I guarantee you, it ran whatever estate it lived in.
Poodle with a bare ass.
So, Love in Paradise. Love During Lockup is back. We put the first episode of it on our regular feed. The subsequent episodes will go on the $8 Reality Gaze tier, the cringe tier.
RG Plus.
There's some whoa.
It's going to be the mix the Lalu is of a little bit of fun crazy and a little bit of
sad.
I'm worried.
Addiction.
Yeah, all of it.
There's a good simp though. We got a simp in the style of Deontay, a la Deontay.
We do. Yeah. Will we have a Nicole Jr. funeral? I don't know.
Nothing will ever
God,
get that.
Oh, it was the best.
I think we can just jump in. Should we just jump in? Jump in. Y'all, Gino and Jasmine, Coco is in a stroller and he wants to run free.
Just watching them chase Coco made me laugh.
And
so
as
much.
They say, he loves to meet people. And Jasmine goes, especially men. I talked to the vet. It's a sexual orientation thing. But she
it's
says,
okay, I love him. Don't matter what.
I love Coco no matter what. And Gino says, maybe that's why he likes to rub against me so much. He's like, no, you're
don't,
his dad.
Don't be sick. You are his dad, Gino.
So apparently, Coco is homosexual, which tracks.
Tracks.
I like it how, you know, I would love to have been a fly on the wall when Jasmine says, is my dog gay?
Yes. And the vet just probably said, yes, just because what else
look
could
at
you
him.
Say? Look at him.
He's a dick pig.
I got to say, though, he's cute, though. That dog, the Madeline's albino dog on Love in Paradise freaks me the fuck out.
The albino Pomeranian?
Yes.
Angel?
Okay, so Jasmine, good news, bad news. Her mom does have cancer, but it's super, super early. They think she's going to be okay. And then this is like, we get a... it does feel like Jasmine is like in one of those movies where she made a choice and it was the wrong choice and things just keep getting worse in life.
Right.
But
she says she's never been this depressed. And,
yes.
And then Gino says, you know, my mom had cancer in the 70s and she had no chance at all. And it hurts me to see Jasmine distraught and in pain. Hmm. And it's her 37th birthday, which is not really a birthday people celebrate with and call it a name.
When you're depressed and yeah,
but I'm saying you don't really celebrate. It's not it's you don't say it's my 37th birthday and celebrate the number.
Once the something seven means you're on the slide to another zero.
The birthdays
late
the
30s.
The numbers you say when someone says, "Oh, it's my birthday." You don't need to say it's my 37th birthday. The numbers are birthdays that end in zero, some that end in fives. I'm okay with that.
Look. I think people can say what they want. I think this might be coming from a little bit of a place of someone who doesn't like to disclose his age a lot.
That's not true. I'm just saying no one, you don't need to tell anyone it's my 38th birthday because no one cares. Well, if you say it's my 40th birthday, that's a care about age.
That's a care
even
about
35,
age.
30, 55, anything after 60, you can say a number. Like I'm 61. You can say it.
Is that what you're going to do?
Absolutely not. I'm just saying, and by all means, y'all, you're not allowed. You can say, I'm having a birthday party. I'm having a birthday party or a surprise birthday party. But you cannot say, I'm having a 37th birthday party. There is no such thing. It's a birthday party, or it's a 30th birthday party, or a 40th birthday party. Or you can have a sweet 16. You can have an 18th. You can have a 21st.
Well, this is good, though. I'll make sure when I throw you a surprise to really let everybody know when it happens. It's your 50th birthday, because that's when I can say it.
That's the only time you'll be able to say
when the skywriting comes on, it says Poodle's 50. You can't be angry about it because I'm just saying what you said, doing what you said.
No, I don't have birthdays. I just never change. Just like the seas. I go out and I go in and come back again.
Come back. Speaking of never changing, I do have a little bit of a life update I forgot to tell you about. This retrograde.
What?
Yesterday, the last day of the retrograde. Y'all, one of the poodles stayed in Canada longer. One of the reasons I flew back literally was because getting into my orthodontist is an act of God. And if you move your appointment,
this
especially,
is ridiculous.
Especially now that all these high school kids and kids and middle school kids are all on spring break and they're taking up all the appointment
time. This is absurd.
Well, one of my brackets broke off in the middle of my appointment yesterday. And I thought I was getting my braces off. Nope. Turns out it's going to be longer. And I said, how long do you think, Doc? And he said, I don't want to say anymore because I want to make sure we get everything closer before we take them off. I'll let you know when we're a few months out.
Until you're dead?
I really.
How long have you had braces now?
bit. It's been at least a year. I got them in I think January. I'll have to look. I think it's been a year and a half. It can't be 2 years. No, it's been, yeah.
As a teenager, yeah. I wore braces less than that.
Oh, I had braces for 4 years as a teenager.
Yeah, I know. And it still didn't fix it.
Well, it did. But then I didn't wear my retainer. Anyway, I'm sorry, but actually...
No!
I have a little bit of peanut butter in that bracket.
I need to move on. I need to move on. So Gino is trying to cheer up Jasmine.
Cheer up Jasmine.
Men go with a smile.
And Gino says, let's go to Miami, which is insane that Gino is going to spend that kind of money. I think Matt Sharp probably gave him some money. Probably. Anyway, her friend Leandro is there, and ooh, she's already in the airport in Miami. She feels energized. She's like surrounded by Latinos, and I've never met a Latino in Michigan. And Gino's like, I can try to speak Spanish whenever you want. Your Spanish sucks.
Gino, say arroz.
Say arroz.
Arroz, Gino. Arroz.
So Gino, y'all, cannot roll his tongue. It's impossible for him. And what if she says, I'll show you where to put your tongue?
He said, you have to show me where to place the tongue. And that's what she said. I'll show you. Hey-o.
So, y'all, then she starts talking about it. She's describing, she's like, one time I told Leandro, it was my fantasy to fuck in a semi-public place. And he's like, he told me to do it.
And she's I did.
So I can't. And he's like, oh, yeah, I want to. Maybe we can do that. Maybe a woman. And then I can join in. She goes, you want me to cut your dick off, blend it up, and make a smoothie and force you to drink it?
It's beautiful. But I loved the line where she said, it made one of my fantasies come true.
Don't worry. I have many, many, many more fantasies. Many.
I will say they are very joyful. So anyway, we meet Leandro, who is hot. Gay, right?
He's got to be gay. I hope he's gay. He is
hot. We need to see if Leandro's single. Because maybe it's when we're down in Fort Lauderdale, maybe I can do a one-on-one interview.
You know,
he can put one in my one.
Yeah, but you already have a man.
He can put his one in my two.
You already have a man, friend. So probably I'm single. He can just, I can take care of it. Don't you worry about it. I know you're busy.
No. Maybe he'll just be our third.
Oh, God.
Y'all don't bring sand to the gay beach. Don't. Yeah. Anyway, he is hot, and they see his house. The house is amazing. He says he's renting. This guy must have money or something.
Or he just got like an Airbnb.
It's a really nice Airbnb.
No, I took it when he said he rented it, like he rented it while he was there for a short, like an Airbnb. But maybe it is he. Yeah, it looked too not lived in.
Yeah, I agree.
To be someone's real home.
So they get her cupcakes, and her one wish is for the kids to be in the U.S. and for her mother's health. And she said, I didn't know how lucky I was before, and I took it all for granted. Of course, she's crying because that's what Jasmine does.
She does.
But none of that matters because Mahmoud's on the Mach move.
Now, look, I said this to you before we started, but I'm thinking one of the reasons they're delaying Angela and Michael is, are we going to get Nicole and Miss Mood half season? Because I feel like bitch is leaving. He's done. He's going to vogue his way across the pond.
I would support that because Team Miss Mood all the way. Some of you asked about that someone said, because they keep putting the K in Mahmoud or Mahmoud, it's actually, it's like a German, so in Arabic, it's somewhere. So it's Mahmoud. You don't actually say the K.
Okay.
Like German, say Ach.
Ach.
Yeah, Mahmoud.
I just call him Miss Mood.
But when you said it, you've used a K. And that's what Julian is doing.
Julian.
Anyway,
Poor Julian. He's like on the begging.
He's on the street and Mahmoud's just running around and Julian's like, please stop voguing.
Please stop voguing. Don't vogue in the street. You'll get ran over by that Corolla.
I think they're on Western. It looks like they're on Western, that part near Los Feliz.
Maybe. I mean, that's where that's I went. Where I looked at the like. Shop that he went to and it was in Echo Park.
Yeah, it looks like they're right there. And because there's big houses. Anyway, he's like, I need to go find a place to stay for the night. This is the thing, y'all. Mahmoud doesn't feel like he's doing it just because he's mad at her. Like, he's feeling, he doesn't feel, there's a feel, part of it doesn't feel safe for him.
Yes, and Julian's acting like Julian. There's a camera crew following him.
You're going to be fine.
But when Julian's saying, don't go anywhere. And he's like, just let me alone. Let me be. And Julian keeps touching him. And I hate that.
Ugh.
And so he's like, let
like
me be.
Like when they put their fucking hands on him.
And then I think Julian needs to work through his codependency issues. Because when he looked at Mahmoud and said, can I just stand here? I won't say anything. And I went, look, I can be a helper. But I've never done that.
Nicole, meanwhile, is back at her hovel. And she says, I wish you guys didn't see that. I'm just so embarrassed. It's still all about her. It's incredible.
Also, she wanted them to see it.
Exactly.
So don't lie.
And she's like, for the last 4 years, I tried as hard as I can. When does he have to try? When is it Mahmoud's turn? And then she's like, I just should have let the night be fun for everyone. And she calls Miss Mood. And the first answer he goes is, what? what?
He says, okay, so listen to this bullshit. He's going to stay at a hotel, he says. He doesn't want to talk right now. And she said, okay, well, maybe that's better. And she hangs up the phone. And she
feels
feeling
mad and disrespected.
The producers take care of him. They take it to a hotel. The next day, she's pissed off that Mahmoud charged a hotel on her card
because
his was declined because he probably...
Either some international rules or didn't have enough money in it. And yeah, she's furious that he used her money.
That's what she's upset about, how disrespectful. And I was like, you really are a stone cold bitch.
We should be, if you're not... absolutely appalled at this behavior. Again, I hate saying this, reverse the genders. And you would be appalled.
Yeah.
Anyway, Miss Mood is still wearing his flip-flops on the street.
He is.
And they're at the Coffee Bean. You know that's where they are. He's getting a tea. And
it's actually called Glowing Plant. That's how I looked
it
up.
Oh, is it?
I looked it up, and that place is in Echo Park.
Oh, so they are over there. Mm-hmm. So it looked like the Coffee Bean, like the colors inside. Anyway, he even says, I don't care if she comes to the house with her friends, but I don't like the way she acts around them. And she was acting like Big Shot. She was acting like, yeah, this is my new fiance. Sure, I'll pour some alcohol for you, although I really don't love it.
And the thing that he said that shocked me is when he said, I would still love to see her or I would love to see her and because I'm hopeful that there's possibly a way to fix things. And I went, wow.
He calls her and she's like, how are you? She's like, all right. He calls her and he's like, I'm terrible. And then Nicole's like, I was mad at you. You were mean to me all day long. Immediately berating, not trying to talk about what happened.
And she yells about the card, yeah.
You didn't get to meet my friends. You've done nothing but make problems for me since you've been here. You charged my credit card for your hotel. And then she says, oh, y'all take this in. For the last 4 years, all you've done is cause problems. And he's like, yeah, I want to get my stuff.
Yeah.
And she's like, okay, give me a couple hours. And that's it. Y'all,
I just want to remind everybody, because I had a moment of forgetting this, because she's either had decent Botox and takes care of her skin. She's 40 years old.
Yes. No.
I think we forget that because she looks younger and she acts so young.
Oh, youthfulness is not a, it's not an excuse here.
But
anyway,
she's way old enough to know.
She's showing up like Emily in Burbank with her black beret.
That's
stupid, like she's about to go to a painting class. I just want to like just rip it off because she's so pretentious.
She is.
She dressed to so because she was going to be filmed and she wanted to be filmed a certain way. And she's like, some part of me wants to make things work and another part wants things to just go. But he's been on his own. On his own in a city he doesn't know. And he has his flaws and they're super annoying, but I still love him. And then they had this really uncomfortable, you hungry? No, I ate. Where are you staying? I don't know. And
she says, it's strange to me that he has no desire to work things out. And I thought,
how?
But he does. You just completely, you're shutting him. This all started because he's leaving because she screamed at him. Get out, we're done, yeah. We're done. Move out of my house, get out, like repeatedly.
Make no mistake. This is abusive behavior. This is abusive behavior. This is really abusive. The next thing she says to him is, where are you going? And then she says, you act like you've been here for 20 years. You don't know where you're fucking going. Basically calling him stupid.
She thinks he's stupid. I do think that. Yeah. She thinks that.
And he said, well, you asked me to get out. And then she goes, you're the one you told me you want a divorce. And he says, I still want that. Then go.
He says that it's over and he will go to Egypt somehow, some way. And now is that the plot line? It's like an Egyptian tale to get back home.
I was just saying this is Fievel goes east. Fievel goes west.
Yes.
Fievel goes Middle East.
Fievel goes Middle East. There you go.
Our relationship is over. I have no plan, no phone, and I don't know what to do. And unfortunately, maybe he and his mother just sing to each other somewhere out there.
Yeah, she is the one. She is the one singing.
Hopefully he can vogue his way over the ocean.
It is a dance remix, yes.
Yeah.
Not a ballad.
Emily and Kobe! Not a lot here. She's just walked off. And Kobe says, this is interesting. Kobe says, we don't need to get to this level. We can hang out. The problem here is they are talking over her. And she's like, I hate being interrupted.
Mm-hmm.
And he's basically saying, he goes and gets her. And she said, I don't want you to get upset. This is African culture. I'm an African man, and my friends are trying to protect my interests. We've had some people push back and say, this is, I don't know if we have anybody specifically from Cameroon. We have had people from Nigeria, people from Nigeria and Ethiopia saying it's not as patriarchal as they are making it out to be. I'd be interested to talk to some Cameroonians, especially this area of Cameroon. Which is further west where they are.
Yeah, we don't
know. If it's this patriarchal and if Emily should have cooked them an entire meal. So Cameroonian sissies come at us. I want to be specific with this because I don't want to call Africa a monolith. Obviously.
Well, I talked to my Lyft driver last night when we were going to the thing.
From Cameroon?
No, he's from Gambia. And which is in West Africa.
Remember what I said about not making Africa a monolith?
No, but I brought up because he was talking about his family and he was talking about the different names, like his older brother. I'm not going to remember the name, but his older brother was considered a king. His older sister had a place. And then he was one of nine brothers. So they were meant to like support So anyway, and he was born in L.A., but raised in West Africa by his mom, and then moved to L.A. back like 4 or 5 years ago. So he had both. And so I asked him, because also we were in the car with my friend Ned, who's a big fan of the show, and the one that you think is hot, Sarah Jane.
Oh, yeah.
He is a hot man. And so she's gorgeous, too. But he said, though, I said, how big a deal would that be? And he would said, he said it would be a very big deal to bring someone in married. And I kind of explained the situation. I said, but what if they already are married in the U.S. and have two kids? I said, would you, as a friend? He was like, no, I wouldn't. The deed is they have a life together. That's very different than someone bringing a white American woman. He said, but the bossy, but he said the bossy thing would not fly.
Yeah. And I think
so that's what, yeah,
I think that's, and that's why I hate the term. I hate the term bossiness being used here, because it's just a cultural dynamic that,
that's
a
good point.
I don't think it's outright misogyny. Like, these men aren't saying we hate women. They're saying it, this is how things are, and this is what's worked for us. We don't know anything else. Because misogyny implies a comparison.
People are, sissies are kind of all over about this. I feel like,
what I have a problem is, can't she just, y'all, she's here for how long? Just.
I will say
less
she,
mouth running and just more listening.
Well, she doesn't like to be talked over by her friends, but she talks over Kobe when he's
she
trying to
always
talk to her.
Talks over him.
So you spot it, you got it, girl. So like, because he was trying to calmly talk to her, and I wanted, at least from the edit, I was like, girl, just let him finish. Let him finish his sentence.
One thing I wish that she could say that I wish she could would really help. Just she could say, I understand how you feel. He even says, sorry, I'm trying to get this between, I'm an African man and I'm stuck between two cultures. And she doesn't respond to that or validate him. She says, no, it's like five of them are against me.
Yeah. And I think if she just validated him, it's because she said, though, but you didn't say anything that hurt my feelings. They kind of start to talk a little bit about how they felt. And Kobe finally says, which was a good thing. He says, can you just do this for me? And
for a couple more days.
She's kind of like, okay, but then they come back and
that goes out the window.
Well, I got to say that I do. Yes, it's cultural, and either Valerie's getting paid well to be an asshole or he's really keyed
her.
Up about
he's trolling her really hard.
And so Kobe kind of, kind of said what we talked about last episode. Why doesn't Kobe just say, look, this is where it is. We've like the deed's been done. He says that.
He kind of does. The friends say, look, when in Cameroon, when the men talk, the women stay quiet. And she goes, yeah, I don't do that. And then she gets a bottle of Jack Daniels and pours a shot.
It is interesting, though, that I would think I would be interested. Is there an expectation of men in Cameroon to think that if an American woman came over, she would immediately know how to assimilate to their standards for women?
It's not about that. What I would say is their culture, you are where they are. It's a matter if you don't know or not.
Mm-hmm.
You just do it. Mm-hmm. Here's the thing is, the men are telling you, you don't have to know anything. Mm-hmm. But she's saying, no, I disagree with you, I'm American.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference. They are full on filling her in on how women behave in this country. She keeps saying, I'm an American, so I don't have to behave that way in your country.
Mm-hmm.
But it is the way Americans go through the world, that they are Americans first, and every culture bends to what they have to do.
No, that's very true, yeah.
And so that's what's being illustrated here. It's much less about misogyny. It is much more about I will act how I want to, when I want to, when it suits me.
But it's also about what Kobe brings up, his friends not caring about their friend, meaning Kobe, and not having any empathy, sympathy, whatever you want to call for his situation. And I'm glad that he called them out on that finally at the end. It was like, look, if you're not against it, then don't show up. And he walks away and they fucking, they freak out like just like angry gremlins.
Yeah. I think for her, for her to say, this is what kind of gets me, and I wish she hadn't have gone this far. She says, I'm never going to be good enough for them in their eyes. Maybe they shouldn't come to the wedding if they don't support our relationship. Mm-hmm. I think even if you didn't get along with them, I would let that go. Mm-hmm. Because what she's doing now is, I hate the term bossy, she's literally taking over who can come to their wedding. Mm-hmm. And that's shitty. Yeah. So,
and she says, so she does say, she's like, I think they're trying to sabotage our relationship, but I want them to come because I know that'll make Kobe happy.
What I'm trying to think about, what this is why I'm thinking this may be a little fraudacity. What would she in her mind think that they would get out of sabotaging the relationship of a man who already has two children with a woman? Mm-hmm. So I guess that's where the motivation comes there. It feels to me, feels like her inner monologue is, you don't like me, you don't like me, you don't like me. And it's less about separate supporting the relationship.
And maybe there is fraudacity in it, because if they really do care this much and are this emotional and are trying to sabotage his relationship, those are fucking bad friends.
Yeah, and to have they have two kids, and it doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
It doesn't.
Pantais.
This is starting to make a lot of sense.
Wow, y'all.
Y'all, you think it's all fun because, you want a witch river? They're all funny, but don't get it twisted. Patrick and John have childhood trauma. Well,
this is not John's father.
Oh, this is not.
Patrick and John have different fathers.
They do. Same mom. Yeah. Forgot about that.
Who had addiction issues. Yeah. But Jose, Patrick's dad, shows up. He's like, hey, you're here for a while. I brought some paint for the apartment. I'm going to just do him like John.
Can you clarify something for me? Maybe you understood it. I was confused. Thais was saying, do they give him money to help pay for the apartment, or they have to pay him rent?
No, they pay him rent. They pay him rent when they stay there.
Okay, got it.
This father's a narcissist, y'all. Let's just call it. This is someone who thinks they are owed a lot of stuff, even though he wasn't really in Patrick's life.
And Patrick is so desperate to have any type of love from his father.
Yeah,
he'll do anything he says.
And then he said, my dad and I have a complicated relationship. I barely got to see him. Then he retired to Brazil, which is not Pat's problem. And later on, and Thais is basically like, we didn't know you were coming tonight. In fact, we didn't go see my dad either. And dad's like, well, I'm here because I need you to do a lot of stuff tomorrow. We're going to clean the walls, and then we're going to paint. We're going to do everything in 3 days. So dad owns the apartment. They pay rent. And then
Patrick doesn't need to be on a – like, he has one fucking good leg.
Yeah. Y'all, the father has raised their rent on them several times. This is so sketchy.
And they haven't even been there in 2 years.
I'm just like – come on.
It's sketchy as fuck. He even gives me schmarmy vibes when
you
walk in the room.
Anyway, Patrick's like, I like helping out my dad. As long as he gives me attention. Dad, play catch with me, please. Please,
Dad. You can tell Thais really loves him, because actually I think she's been, y'all, we've seen Thais in the past. She can come for him, but she's really kind of treating this with a little bit of kid gloves for him, because she gets that this is
unwinnable.
Frustrating. Yeah. Well, and he's a fucking straight guy who doesn't talk about feelings and emotions. And it's just like, it's good. It's good. It's good. It's fine. It's great. Yeah. And she knows, though, that he's like underneath is just a ball of anxiety about this.
Yeah, it's just This is when you, as his wife, I don't know if she can really get in the middle of this conflict. This is never going to be solved. The only one who would be able to help this is John. she can't get involved.
I don't know if she, the only problem is that maybe not now, but as she gets older, what type of relationship is he have with their children, like she could maybe have to get involved later.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think John could help. I'm at first I was glad John was coming to troll them and make things funny. And now I'm actually glad John is coming to help support Patrick.
I agree because y'all, the Goodwill Hunting brothers are always going to do what's in the best of each other's interest more.
Mm-hmm.
I was just going to say, even when what John thought he was doing with Thais there was at least trying to be protective of Patrick regardless. So they are always going to, even Patrick, when he was talking to Megan and throwing her under the bus, both of them are trying to protect the other because they had no protection from either of their parents.
No.
And so they were only they had. And y'all, if you think about it, it's sad.
It's very sad. And
it's so trauma informed.
It's not that Thais, I agree, it's probably better for her not to be fully involved when she doesn't have to be. But I would want her to know this isn't for you to fix because she didn't cause it. She can't cure it. She can't control it. And so it's for them to go to therapy and for Patrick to just learn to say no.
Good luck.
He even says, she says, she's like, I didn't know your dad was coming. I didn't want to do chores. And Patrick says, well, he brought the paint to be nice. How is that nice to bring? Because, you know, I remember being as a kid, you see your dad or my grandpa was the worst about this. Like the grandkids, we would come over and we would have to help him chop wood or do something.
Chores, yeah.
We'd have to do a chore, but it wasn't like the whole time. And also nobody had a torn ACL.
Us, it was kind of like work was to build character for us.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't be lazy. And that was the idea.
So you would know how much hard work goes into things.
And being, from where we grew up, being lazy is the worst possible thing you could ever be. These are adults.
This is not picking up pecans like my grandpa Pete had me do. This is painting an entire apartment.
What? You had to pick up pecans off the ground?
Oh, yeah, because he had a bunch of pecan trees. And so we'd go and pick up all the pecans for my grandma Valley and my mom and my other cousins.
Sell them?
Yeah, and then we'd take them around.
Make pecan pie?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Yeah.
So. It's a little To Kill a Mockingbird there. And Boo Radley was just waving at you.
What if I was Boo Radley?
Whoa, you were. No, actually, I swear to God, sometimes my childhood feels like To Kill a Mockingbird, but sadly there was no lawyer that ever defended Tom. Someone just accused a black man and probably threw him in jail. There was no Atticus Finch.
That second book was
there
terrible.
Was a lot of Boo Radleys, though. A
lot of Boo Radleys. Lot.
What? A lot of Mayella Ewells.
Yeah. So Thais says.
And I was just scout running around like a little lesbian.
Because Thais is right. As a renter, they shouldn't have to do shit. But it's his dad.
I know.
So you want to help your dad out. And Patrick's like, he doesn't have a lot of money. But yeah. I think Thais brings up, it's not just this. Patrick is really bad. And I get it. As someone who like worked on codependency, sometimes he's way more in denial of seeing a whole picture. You just seeing one thing as one instance. But I bet you he's asked them of so much more shit. Y'all don't pull over, by the way.
Also, I feel like when he uses it, when he's trying to talk to Thais, but he's like, I'm just trying to be a good son. And in a way, he starts to... What the dad does is build a wall between him and his wife. Mm-hmm. And what the dad will say, you're such a good son, and thanks for doing this for me. Or maybe he never even says thanks.
I don't think he does.
And it's, oh God, this is not a good place for them to be in. Yuck.
Loren and Alexi, tomorrow is the mummy makeover.
And Alexi is still apt to sabotage.
As Marlene wants him to do.
Thank you guys for saying they need to get the fuck away from this mom. She's just so awful.
No wonder they want to move across the fucking ocean.
Her behavior's been appalling for some of these seasons. Yeah.
Oh, it has been. And apparently it was, we didn't even see the worst ones.
She was awful in there when they were about to move to Israel. She was awful.
My favorite thing about them, what I do love about them is, what I like about them is they have like normal couple fights, but then usually Loren gets way more dramatic and Alexi stays so calm. But this whole idea of like, look, I'm not doing the laundry five times like you do. I'm going to do it all at once. I fold the little socks because you know I fucking hate that. It was just such a, I think like it's such a relatable moment that a lot of
couples. It does feel like a slice of life.
Yes, that's a good word for it.
And then he says, you know, and I don't know how she's like, it's going to be, at least it'll be cleaner because you're not very clean. And she looks horrified that he said it on camera. It's like Shy is cleaner than you are.
Her makeup is everywhere. She seems like one of those girls. Remember when you visited girlfriends in high school and you thought you were messy and then you see their bathroom and you're like, holy.
There's just shit everywhere. Yeah.
Everywhere. Just banana clips all over the counter. I remember that.
Dr. Pepper lip smackers.
Yes.
So the doctor comes in and they're talking about, he's still trying to find something. They're like, side effects, maybe fluid buildup. You talked to me about they had to change your drains, which I just found really gross.
So this is what that changing your drains, it's not that big of a deal. You feel like it's super gross.
It's fluid, isn't it?
It's painless, but yeah, you have to, it's like a, you know, it's a drain of fluid and you have to, they kind of look like little like boob implants and they're annoying because you kind of safety pin them to your clothes, but you have to drain them every two or three times a day and then write down how much fluid is in it.
Ugh.
And pass. Then but you have to do it for the inflammation. Otherwise fluid can build up, cause inflammation.
What is the fluid?
I don't know. That's
like
a good question.
I remember
my doctor told me it's like preventing it in between one of the layers
like
of your skin
nodes?
And muscle. No,
that
fluid actually wants to go in between a layer of your skin and your muscle, I believe.
Oh.
So it's more the, because I thought, yeah, they were taking something out and the fluid would fill the space.
Right. Well, anyway, y'all, Lauren's ready. She's like, I'm set on it. I'm going to do this. I'm hating the pressure I'm putting on Alexi, but I'm going to do it.
Also, she's had like a legit concern. I've had friends that have had this done where because of having children and things like that, they can't hold their bladder and then they're peeing themselves. So it will fix that.
I think they should let her have her. If she's, it's her fucking body. Let her do a fucking what she
Well, to
wants.
His credit, she says, I've committed to this. I'm set on it. And he said, well, then I've got nothing else to do but support you. And I was like, good husband.
He's just trying to find a more soft pedal way to do it. And this is common in so many relationships where, you know, one person's against something and they're like, I can't really say anything because it'll be World War III. So I'm just going to find a soft pedal way to do it.
Yeah. Can't say a word.
Let's move on, y'all, to Mi Trabajo Es Bruja, Literal Mente and Manuel. This continues to be one of the highlights of Happily Ever After for me. I just want to say, all of this drama, this hand-wringing, this fretting about being a fucking witch could all be vaporized if you could call yourself a different word than a bruja.
Which is
not really what she is. It is actually, she is not a evil crone, which is what the word bruja means.
I actually think it's not for us to say what she is or dictate tell her she's using the wrong word. She can make that up however she wants, but I'm agreeing with you. And don't use that word, because be smart enough to recognize it's not going to get you anywhere. It's not going to get you anywhere with him. It's not going to get you anywhere with his family. Because we saw, one thing that I was impressed by Ashley, because this guy came ask her.
Uncle Leo. Like from Seinfeld. Jerry, hello.
I do remember, because didn't he have a wife that on the show too? His wife? Oh, wait, no, that's Jerry's mom. I love the actress that played Jerry's mom. She was great.
Not helpful.
Anyway, this guy comes with her talking about this, and she played the game. She didn't like, she swallowed some things and said things different, and it's just, there's a difference of hiding who you are.
Yes. And keep going.
With hiding who you are. And I think that gets triggered because she feels like Manuel doesn't, in their own private life, doesn't validate that part of her. So that can feel real. And I get that. But then, but when you go outside, there's a, you don't have to hide who you are, but you can just show that you, that this guy was really intense.
Yeah.
And it really, I think, shocked her. Like, oh, Manuel wasn't fucking kidding about his family. If I say anything about being a witch, they're going to freak the fuck out.
Well, the thing is, she loves saying she's a witch because that ruffles people's feathers. She likes the reaction she gets from it.
It's like that hairdresser on Seeking Sister Wives.
Exactly. That's her whole personality is causing talk and causing controversy over being a witch. And if it can't cause controversy, she's not really happy about it. It feels boring to her. So she doesn't want to call herself a curandera or curandario or something like that. Always get that wrong. But because that's exactly what she is. And that's how it would be said in Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, it's the hard-headed instinct to try to make a good impression, but still want to piss people off a little bit. And I can't help you. You could only help yourself with that. That's why it just feels so stupid to me.
Yeah.
I hope they drop this storyline after this season, because it was a big part of season one and it never really materialized.
Well, I hope they don't drop necessarily the word. I don't ever want them to drop of Manuel rolling his eyes because Ashley's making him doing some ceremony by a black walnut tree in the middle of the night.
That's
that I need forever.
But just her identity as a bruja.
Mm-hmm.
Her identity as a witch.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, and he says, and she the thing about it is she understands. She's like, he has a problem with the word witch. Because fundamentally, it's not what it means for him. And he hears bruja and thinks broomsticks and a long crooked nose. Yes.
Well, she says, it's 2023. A witch is not a person who rides on a broomstick. And Manuel's like, you drive a car. A modern witch.
Even she laughed.
She does laugh.
And then Manuel says, I don't want you to say that word. And she goes, don't try to control me. So now it's a symptom of him trying to control her.
Well, you know what part of it is too? I just kind of imagining, just knowing a bit about Ashley and seeing this, because when we get with Uncle Leo, she softens because she sees the reality and she cares about him. What's happened probably to Ashley, she's been fucked over by so many guys who've gaslit and lied to her.
Yeah.
And so she doesn't believe, we know, they talk about it. That comes from all this trust issue about Manuel. He does something. He is very secretive, but at the same time,
I don't think he has a lot of
she
secrets.
Puts a lot of her mistrust issues from past boyfriends onto him.
Right.
And then what that does for her, girl, but then you look like having egg on your face because you meet Uncle Leo, who's immediately like, Maria, Mary. And you go, oh.
Yeah, he's like that. And anyway, they walk in to see Uncle Leopoldo or Leopoldo, but they keep calling him Uncle Leo, Theo Leo. And he's so happy. And Manuel is so happy to meet him. He hasn't seen him in 7 years.
And when he said, we talk all the time, we usually talk several times a week. And again, you go see her.
Ashley goes, oh.
Oh. Because she doesn't believe anything he says because she can't.
Yeah. This would, I think if I was Manuel, I think that would be the one thing for me where he does get frustrated after a while. He's like, you don't trust me. Anything I say, you won't ever believe me. And if I was him, I would say, so knowing this, that this is coming from your past, how do we move forward? If you don't ever trust anything I say, mm-hmm. how do we move forward? Mm-hmm. What do you think her response would be?
I don't think she's in a place of, Ashley doesn't trust herself.
I agree.
And so that she's got to build that up before she can try to even have any expectation of trust within a relationship.
Yeah. But in relationships I've been in, I've had some issues where, and even when I haven't.
And to answer your question, by the way, I think her response would be not good to that. Sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
But people have expected that I wasn't being truthful with them. Mm-hmm. Even though I'm like Manuel, I don't talk about everything I'm doing.
But and I don't mean this is coming at you, it's very much in your Enneagram 4 thing. You don't often, you sometimes feel like people aren't being trustworthy with you.
Not really. I take a lot of stuff for face value. If they tell me that, I'm assuming that. If not, I'll handle it then.
I tell you shit all the time and you act like I have a secret agenda and get mad at me about it. Literally,
but I'm not in a relationship with you.
But our Enneagram thing even said that a 4 will be distrustful of a 2's sincerity.
Because you're not really trustworthy. Yeah. That's what I'm going to say about that.
That is the one thing people say about me. Matt Maher, not trustworthy.
It's not that you're not trustworthy. It's just that I'm thinking a couple. Sometimes you don't think so. You don't think far enough ahead. And I'm trying. And I'm thinking too far ahead.
I guess we'll let sleeping dogs fuck.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, they leave a dog's fuck. So later on, he's been here for 30 years. He's been here from Ecuador. And Ashley says, I want to know you more. And he's like, of course. The woman comes for the man's rib. Blah, blah, blah. And talking about Bible. And you should hear her go, oh, my God. He's a Jesus freak.
And he full on says, do you believe in Maria? And she goes, Maria?
Maria? You mean the woman who sells tamales down our street? She's great.
He's like, no, Maria. And Manuel's like,
Maria.
He's like, Virginia.
Virginia.
And she is like, huh? What's that word? I'm like, bitch, even I know that's virgin.
And at one point he's like, are you religious? And she's like, como se dice? I work in spirituality, help people with energy, astrology. And he goes, tarot. Oh, I don't believe that. Only in the solamente la Virgen. And he said, but the main thing is believing in God. He's like, yeah, it's a little different than what I did. But I believe in a God.
She does say God. Because he says, trust in God. And she says, without him, we are nothing.
She's
using the universe for God. But
here's the thing. The more family members of his she meets, the more Manuel is just going to chalk up wins in his column of saying, holy fuck, all my family is like this. Maybe saying that I'm a bruja isn't the best idea.
Look,
it's the best thing that can happen.
You don't always need to tell people your beliefs, even your own family. Y'all, do you think when
boundaries
I go
are
home,
wonderful things?
Not boundary, but also your own safety and identity.
Yeah.
Do you think when I go home to Oklahoma, I'm talking to Aunt Peggy about doing tarot cards and my astrology app? No, she would totally start thinking I was like worshiping Satan and start praying for me. And then they don't need to know my
beliefs.
Can
I tell her you do tarot cards?
No. And honestly, if they probably asked me my beliefs, I'd probably lie and say I'm, you know, a big believer of this and that, just because I don't interact with them that much. It's different if somebody is in your daily life, but Ashley's not going to see these people that often.
No, that's the thing.
Like two or three times a year.
Anyway, he says, Manuel says, everyone.
I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Come at me about that.
The thing about this is Manuel even says, trying to kind of help things along. You know, he's like, what others? I don't believe in anything else. And Manuel says, but, you know, everyone's got their beliefs. To try to kind of help it out. And he goes, es verdad. So he was actually helping Ashley there, not throwing her under the bus, which was great. That was a great thing. I like teamwork.
And she says, I'm trying not to fight. And I hope, Manuel, you can see that I'm trying and remember that I'm trying. And he goes, relax, woman, relax. It is like the new age, All in the Family, watching them.
Oh,
like,
my God. That's a great way to put it.
And I said to...
Stop for yourself, Ashley.
Stop for yourself. I will say, another thing, again, y'all can disagree with me, but something I think I've learned is if I do something for someone or give to them, and they don't either give back to me or don't seem appreciative of that, instead of actually guilting them about what I did for them, guess
especially
what,
before
y'all,
it happens,
I just stop giving to them.
Right.
That's it. That's all you have to do. You don't have to tell them anything. Just stop giving to them. And guess what? They'll change or they'll get out of your life and you'll find someone who gives back.
Amen. Later on, we are going out. And what color
my
is
hair,
the
hair? My hair.
What color is the shirt that Manuel is wearing?
Is it hypercolor? Is this a new type?
I don't know. I could not place it in the normal color spectrum.
God, he is so sexy, though. When he fixes his hair and then he kind of shimmies and goes, vamos. That was hot.
They're meeting their friend Aaron for drinks.
This place is called Madam X, by the way. I thought it was a strip club.
She's a colleague in the spiritual space.
Mm, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Aaron works with light language.
Yep.
She talks to aliens.
She sure does.
And Aaron says there were a lot of ET sightings in Ecuador. He's like, yes, I've heard that. He's like, I don't believe it, but I've heard about it.
Yeah.
This person's a fruitcake.
Look, I'm woo-woo as fuck. I'm into all that, but it just, she literally, and everything she found out from talking to them and doing the light language was everything we already knew, that she already knew. Like, nothing was. And also, why are you doing this in the middle of a bar? Like
in the middle of a restaurant or whatever.
Manuel just wants to, like, drink and, like, I love talking about spirituality and things like that. But one thing I do, I can't talk about it all the time. I'm like, Ashley.
Yeah.
It's like maybe it's the edit, but it's all we see her want to talk about. And that's just a lot for anyone.
I think they know that this is good fodder. But they're bringing this person in. This is where it's kind of going. I think even Ashley is kind of like, really?
Yeah.
I don't know. Anyway, y'all,
She does a little reading for them.
What are you doing?
Oh, wait, y'all. Oh, what's happening? What is this beam of light in front of me? Poodles disappeared. Oh my God, there's an alien. An alien in front of us. I guess we're going to interview an alien now. Hello. Hello, alien. Is it Mr. or Miss or just alien?
I am not using your sentimental pronouns.
No,
it begins with a Y and ends with a kerplux.
Okay. Yeah. So, Miss, well, person
you may,
A, or,
you may call
what
me.
What is, you have a name?
You may call me Harvey.
Harvey. Harvey.
In your okay. language.
Okay, Harvey.
Yes.
Why are you showing up today, Harvey, in the middle of our podcast?
Well, I was told to come and see you as I was brought in to read the light language.
Yes. Oh, for this couple.
Manuel and Bruja.
What do you think? By the way, Poodle's gone somewhere. Is he being probed right now?
Oh, we are probing him good, but we've lost 4 probes already. They're going to bring in the big guns.
Big probes. I got that.
Yeah. Hold on. Is there no bigger one available? Go, Robin. Maintenance.
I just let them know if he screams and says stop, he actually means keep going.
Yeah, we've had that happen.
Okay. So Harvey, what do you think about Manuel and Ashley?
Well, she seems to have something that I often refer to on the planet Rextron as you'd have to pronounce it correctly. I'd have to swallow your human tongue.
Oh, okay. So, but what could you translate it? What would that mean in English language?
She's hard to deal with.
Oh, okay.
It's a very complex thing on the right strong.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. What advice would you give to them to make things better?
She could always cut off his head and then parade around it and then put it on another body like we do on my home planet. Oh, carf.
Harvey, we don't do that here.
Or they could just sit down and talk like two normal human beings.
Oh, they don't do that here either. They do often do aliens often... bang it out, fuck it out, like alien sex to like get over things.
No, that is how we get on conflict resolution. However, we must, before we do that, we must create the long pack, peace pact for rich, peace impactful resolution.
That's hard for an alien to say.
Yeah, I don't have an actual, my tongue is in 11,000 pieces.
You're safe here.
And then so we sit down and I envelop my head in another person's head. And then we say, I see you. I love you. I want to be your friend. And then we suck each other's dicks.
Ah, that and there we go. Ladies and gentlemen, Harvey the Alien.
Yes.
I see the light is going back up.
I will tell you, your planet will be exterminated in about 100 years.
Okay, well, I won't be here.
Have fun.
Thanks, Harv. Love ya.
Peace out.
Hey, bring back Poodle if you want. Wow, Poodle, are you okay? You look a little flustered.
Whoa. God, that was like that time in Vaseline Alley.
Wow.
Whoa. Wow. What? I could have taken more, though, to be honest.
Yeah,
they need to make the probes bigger.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
They seemed a little freaked out from the STD test, though. So
there was
a lot. That's why they put me back. They were afraid they were going to give something to them.
Yeah.
Lovely people.
Hope you saw Ryan Gosling up there.
Comfortable cot, really.
There we go.
Yeah.
Nice decor.
Yeah. we'll do a...
Very clean. A lot of chrome.
Gah. Okay, yeah, that makes it just sterile.
Y'all, this fruitcake basically tells them, starts moving her hands. You're attracted on a soul level, but the biggest red flag is communication. By the way, this is, you could meet them and tell them this.
Yeah, I'm like, I wrote, can we just have drinks? Can we just have drinks? And so it's like Aaron said, you know, you, Ashley, you could teach Manuel some things. And I went, did she pay her for this? Because it feels like she did. And that's where Manuel says, I don't feel like I have her trust. And I got to say, Ashley completely,
I know,
invalidates what he's saying and said, no, I don't have your trust, and makes it all about her. And freaks out, is yelling at him. And she says, why are you caressing the narrative for me? She's like, I fucking can't.
And then he basically says, I've never given her reason not to trust me. I trust her, but she doesn't trust me. And he says, the fault is hers, not mine. And this is the thing, y'all. When both people think that they're doing the lion's share and dragging the other person along, you're getting nowhere.
Yeah.
And that is what both people think right now. Both people think that they are the ones keeping their relationship afloat. Mm. And it is, that's bad. I can't see, without any type of couples therapy, I don't know if he'll go.
But he didn't want to go.
Yeah. I can't see, she actually needs, does she have, I wonder if she has an individual therapist. She needs to talk about her relationship and just to bring him in. What she could do is bring him into her individual sessions where the therapist could just help her talk to him in a way that doesn't feel like she's treating him like a child.
I think if you brought to her individual, he would feel like she was the problem. I will say, I think Ashley has a better chance of changing than Manuel does. And I think if Ashley wants this relationship to work, because he is stubborn, he is like the machismo. If she wants this to work, she's got to really look at what is she willing to sacrifice on and what actually matters to her.
Right.
Because it's going to be a long time for him to change. Maybe fatherhood will change him more, but I don't.
What do you think he needs to change? But besides... besides, I think, the
I think where she needs to use a different word.
Yeah.
I think
it's much more than that, though.
Yes. But I mean, like, just as an example, where she needs to use a different word, he needs to, we laugh at it, but it's probably insulting to her that he's always rolling her eyes at her, making fun of her, of a witch. Like, sometimes they laugh. I don't know. I can't tell that, but I feel like if that is that important to her, if that's constantly, you never get anybody who seems to validate. Because he can say, hey, I don't believe this, but I love that this means something for you and gives you peace. I think even if he said that he's like, I love that you have this for you, she would be happier.
To me, the trust thing is the worst. If she doesn't trust him, where do they go?
Yeah.
I don't know.
He is the one that didn't tell her that he hadn't told her kids. Like, he has kept things from her.
Like, that's been the pattern.
And that is, so he needs to change that. I guess
I figure my thing next is, he says, look, I'm sorry. I did not tell this with you. I'm going to tell you as much as I can, but know that we still, the kind of person I am, there are still certain things. We don't each have to say everything to each other all the time like you do. That's not how trust works for me.
They both so need accountability. He does and she does. Because the only time that we get vulnerable moments from Manuel is when he talks about something that he feels bad, sad, because he's here.
Yeah.
But it's never – he has yet to – I've seen, at least he has yet to acknowledge – her pain. And no matter when we're with someone, we need that other person to be able to see and validate our pain in some way.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what he could change.
I wish maybe he won't do this because he feels like he doesn't want to talk about previous relationships. If he could actually say, why don't you trust me? Could we talk about some things but is there other reasons why you don't trust men in relationships?
But he kind of, I think that would be fantastic. But don't you think he kind of acts like, I think he does, but he acts as if he has no curiosity about it and he would never ask that. And that,
you're right.
She's a curious person and that upsets her.
You're right.
Anyway, that's the show.
I think they're DOA. I think they'll divorce after 3 years.
I hope they, but yeah, it's going to be rough.
Sorry, y'all. I really don't believe this. I don't believe either of them have enough commitment to it to ride it out. Yeah. I don't know. We'll see. Oh. I think he would stay with her as long as possible. I think she would be the one.
Yeah.
Or maybe he'll get so fed up. I don't know. I don't think they're happy, but are they happy? I don't think they're really progressing.
I mean, but they
I don't know. It takes a long time with marriage.
It does.
Unless you kill them after the first couple of months, like it's easier to do. I've heard.
Uh-oh, y'all. We've got to end the show. Before we did all this episode in one, we're still kind of playing with that format, so there's not a part two. So you've gotten everything.
Hole in one. Next one they told me in college.
Wow. Oh, the alien college, Harvey. Good to know.
Yes.
Go to realitygaze.com, everybody. Go to our link tree on our Instagram and Twitter, and that's where you can buy tickets to our shows in Nashville and Florida. Harvey, we call these people lonely hearts, because aren't we all just lonely hearts looking for love in all the wrong places?
Yes. And if you've ever walked yourselves a fur for horses, you can call me in the night light ranged era.